about time to begin our Bible study. And I don't even like, I hate to call you down. I don't want to do it. But it's about that time anyway, so we'll get started. It's so good to see everyone. And there's some people in Chicago that are watching this morning. They sent a note to me telling me that they were going to be watching, so we want to welcome them to our Bible study, and glad that they are able to be with us today that through the live streaming. We are in 1 Timothy chapter 3, and before we get into that, we have a few announcements that we need to make. Number one, pretty much I think things are pretty much the same as they have been for the last week or two, but Bob Mobley is still at his stepdaughter's house. He's taking therapy there, and Barbara is receiving dialysis. Now, Bob was giving her dialysis at home until before this happened with him, and because of her need for dialysis and all, they had to take her to the hospital, and she's down in Clarksville for that, staying with this daughter. And so we need to keep her in our prayers. April Lovell, this is Vicki English's sister. We reported that her cancer has returned and she's not doing very well. Vicki's very concerned about her. And then Gail Fuller is doing well, everything, and keeping in touch with them and things. I've heard that she's doing better, but still one of those things that it's not just immediate, but hopefully that they may even be with us today. I'm just not sure what the circumstances will be. Waynette was telling me a moment ago that Johnny Westerfield, this is Bill's sister-in-law, passed away. If you'll remember, we had mentioned her several months ago, actually, and her cancer had returned and things, and it was not a good outlook, not a good prognosis. So please keep her in your prayers. And Kay is having quite a bit of problem with this hip. It's a lot of pain relative to her hip and to her legs especially. But the medicine that she's taking is very, very strong, and it is creating other problems. So please keep Kay in your prayers, and I know that she would appreciate that. The bulletin has other announcements in there that you can take a look at. These immediately are the only ones that I have that that we need to just go through, but the other announcements you can read through there and check on those. If there are others who are sick right now, I don't know it. We'll say that Claire and Jaron Tickner flew back to Australia this past Thursday, and they had to go from Nashville to Dallas, and then from Dallas all the way to Australia, 17 hours nonstop in that plane. But Peter told us yesterday that they made it just fine, got home, and started back to the business of getting into life again. But at any rate, Peter and Laura, Millie and I are going to take them to Nashville tomorrow. They're not due to leave until Wednesday, but this weather system coming in with the prospect of ice and some snow and things like that, and the cold temperatures, there was question whether or not we'd be able to get them from here to Nashville. As you know, the weather model has changed several times. And so for Tuesday and Wednesday, we weren't supposed to get there. And then they said, well, the line may have moved south. And so I'm not sure what's going to happen. So what we're going to do is we're going to take them to Nashville tomorrow. They will stay in a hotel there in Nashville near the airport for until Wednesday. And then the hotel has a shuttle that will take them to the airport, and they'll be flying back. They'll go to Dallas and then on to Australia. So please keep Peter and Laura in your prayers. He is over at Eagle Way this morning giving a report there. That's in Hopkinsville. And then they will be at Northside in Mayfield tonight for the service there. So please keep them in your prayers. Are there others that I have left out? I hope not, but if I have... Yes, Millie saw that, and I forgot. I'm glad you brought that up. Gail Hall, who's one of the elders at Calvert City, his mother passed away. And I don't know if any of you remember, but his father passed away just... November, it's like November, December. It's just been a couple months. And so he's lost both of his parents here in the space of about 3 months or less. So I'm sure Gail would appreciate any prayers. Some of you may have known his father, Don Hall. He was a gospel preacher. I know he preached in Marshall County. I'm not sure where. I know he preached at Walnut Grove and at Maple Hill, those two congregations. And some of you may have heard him in the past or remember him from the past. Preached at Cuba. Yeah, there were several places around Mayfield that he was. Yes, he was. I'd forgotten that. Yeah. So Don Hall passed away. That's been a couple months ago. But Gail's mother now passed away, so please keep them in your prayers. Are there others that I've overlooked? I try on Sunday mornings to go through my Facebook real quick to see if anybody's reporting illness or need for prayers, things like that. And just immediately, these are the ones that I know about. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, we come to your throne of grace, thankful for the many things that we have received from your hands of mercy. We know, Father, that you have blessed us beyond measure, and we are satisfied, Father, that you have taken care of us in this life and that you've helped us along, that your presence is always with us, and that we know that you have your eyes upon us. And we pray that the way we live and conduct ourselves will be acceptable in your sight. We are thankful for Jesus and for him being our Savior and knowing that he came to this world and gave up all the privileges of heaven that he might be with us and that he might, in the process, teach us, lead us to you, and die for our sins. Father, we thank you that he is at your right hand today and that all things are under your control and that no matter what is taking place in this world, that we know that as your children, we can expect your loving and watchful care and protection. As we come to you, we remember those who are sick and ask that you will bless them. And we know that some are sorrowing over the passing of someone in their family or their friends or whoever somebody that they have loved for some time. And we ask for you to comfort their hearts and take care of them. And we pray that all things will be good. As we go through our Bible study and worship, we pray that we will learn from your word. We ask, Father, that you will bless us with your kind grace and mercy, that as we go through life and as we live, that we will conduct ourselves in a manner that is acceptable in your sight, and that when we worship you today, that we will worship you in spirit and in truth. Be with us until the end of time, and someday give us a home with you in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I guess probably every time I start a class or worship or something, we ought to welcome those who are watching on live stream. Every once in a while I'll get a notice from someone, well, I saw your lesson the other day and enjoyed this Bible study or the worship or whatever it is. And they don't always write in comments, but there will be people who will write to me personally, and sometimes after the services are over, they'll put something on there. So we are having a live streaming presence of individuals from different places. And I'm not sure where everyone is, but I know it's been about a month ago we had somebody from the Philippines that had watched and put a note on there that they were watching the services and things, and I think that that's a good thing. I'm not a big fan of technology, but one of the things about it is simply that it allows us to go places we could not go before, either that or because it was inaccessible. Or because of money or lack of people to go and things like that. So we're having an opportunity to preach around the world. Well, we are in 1 Timothy chapter 3, and we've been talking about the qualifications for those who are elders. One of the things, and I don't know why I didn't think about this when we first discussed it, but in verse 1 and 2, when he's talking about a bishop in the King James, the word that is used there is, I pointed out, is the word Greek word episkopos, and it means overseer. And an overseer was one who was a steward, you might say, of an estate, one who managed an estate. I think one of the things that we need to remember is that the responsibility of an elder, he is described as a shepherd, which means that he must be leading and caring and feeding and so forth. The second thing that we need to remember about this is that he is also a steward. Hebrews 13, verse 17, I think, brings this out about as well or better than anything else. For they watch for your souls as they that must give account.
You go back to some of the things Jesus taught in the Gospels, and remember that in the parables and so forth, that he talked about on several occasions, he talked about those who were stewards of an estate. In other words, their responsibility was to manage the affairs of the estate, whatever crops, any money that was spent, taken in, things like this, paying others that were working and so forth like that. So one of the things that I like to bring out is that one who is an elder is an overseer, that is a steward. And one of the subjects in the Bible is the idea of stewardship. And there's stewardship of our money, there's stewardship of our time, of our opportunities, and on and on and on it goes. So we could talk about that, but one of the things, an elder is one who in that sense, I guess you would say, has an additional stewardship. And as we go through the qualifications, we've been talking about the fact that the qualifications have primarily to do with the character of the individual who is appointed as an elder. Now, when you get down to then verse 3, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous. Again, you're getting into this. Now, the one not given to wine and no striker sort of go together here. Then you come down, not a brawler. These three sort of go together there. Depending what you're reading, you will find some that say not quarrelsome over wine, and you will find some that say not given to much wine, and so forth as that. And the idea seems to be of one, have you ever seen someone who was intoxicated? And maybe in their intoxication, they want to fight. They're pugnacious. One of the things is being a minister that I have been called many, many times to come over, and here would be a person who was, however you want to describe it, the best way I know to put it is they were just simply drunk. But I'll use the word intoxicated. There's a story told. Joe Creason used to tell a story, and I think it took place in Elizabethtown. There was a man who was arrested for drunkenness, you know, in the public and so forth. And he had been caught that way before, and anyway, he was brought into court, and the Commonwealth attorney was saying, Your Honor, this man was drunk. And while he was drunk, he did this, and he drank till he was completely drunk, and blah, 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 like this, and kept using the word drunk. And the man's attorney said, Your Honor, I object to him using the phrase drunk so much. He's trying to cast aspersions on my client's character. And so the other attorney looked at the judge and he said, well, you can say he was drunk. You can say he was intoxicated. You can say he was three sheets to the wind or in his cups. But, Your Honor, when you get right down to it, the man was drunk. And that's what we're dealing with here. Well, anyway, one of the things, 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 3, Paul told Timothy, be no longer a drinker of water, but drink a little wine for thy stomachs, oft infirmities and things. And the wine of that day and time, they did have laws of what I want to call it, preservation on grape juice and so forth like that. But it was not uncommon for some of it to have alcoholic content. But the thing is, and I've studied this through the years and looked at this, of myself, I could not make the proof of this, but I read it from others. And that is that what we call wine today is much stronger in its alcoholic content than what they had then. So here's an individual. What he does is he exhibits restraint and self-control in the use of wine. Now, one of the things is the word wine, as it appears in the New Testament, can refer to fermented or unfermented. It can go both ways. And there are times that it definitely means fermented. Paul talks about these and so forth as that. But the idea here is of one who is not given to that, who is careful in their use. And how would, let's say you have an elder that is seen around town, and he's intoxicated. And you read in the news, well, I don't guess we do that now, do we? We used to put in the newspaper the arrest record for a particular week, and so-and-so was caught for speeding, so-and-so this. others, DWI or DUI and things like this and all. So what would it say to the world, and what would it say to the church if an individual were, here's an elder in the church and he's supposed to be a model of the people that are in the congregation, what would we say about an individual who shows a lack of self-control? What would we say, and take this a little bit further, what would we say about one who shows a lack of self-control when it comes to some of the other things that have been mentioned there? He says in verse 2, of good behavior, for instance. And so he doesn't, but then look at the very next thing, no striker, and then come down where he says in the same verse, not a brawler. Now, the word striker there means someone who is pugnacious, someone who's wanting to get in a fight. That's what it refers to. And not a brawler, the same kind of, in other words, and I think, I think it's the American Standard Version, renders that not contentious. I think I'm telling you the right one, I'm not sure. But anyway, sort of the idea that not someone who is not looking for a fight and someone who is not out there trying to be pugnacious and create a fight and a disturbance and so forth like that. How could you preach peace to others if you are not taking care of yourself and avoiding that? So anyway, I can remember a time when someone would say, well, an elder, if he works for a company and they go on strike, he cannot go on strike because the Bible says no striker. Well, that's not the idea here. That's not the idea. I've heard that said. I can remember, you know, discussing this. And that's not what it means. Go ahead. Yes.
You know, it's not just for elders.
Yeah, they all, right. But the elder has to be the one who is setting the example, who is leading, and is able not only to live these things, but to encourage others to live them in the same way. One of the things that I noticed in the New Testament is that self-control is mentioned a lot of times, temperate. To one who is to be temperate, or to like in the Second Peter chapter 5 verses 1 through 8, what we call the Christian Second Peter 1 verses 5 through 8. I'm sorry, got the reference mixed up there. And he talks about adding to your faith virtue, and he goes through this and self-control. That's mentioned there, and you go on through the different times that Paul addresses the brethren, and self-control is one of the things that is mentioned over and over and over. And it's not just simply somebody says, oh, in other words, abstinence. And oftentimes it's thought of in reference to sexual abstinence. Well, yes and no. I mean, that's involved, but that's not all there is to it. The idea of a self-controlled life, one who is in charge of their faculties, their person, they set an example for others. I think I told you, I'm trying to remember, I went to Bowling Green last spring or summer, I can't remember now, I'm trying to even remember why I was, I had gone to Bowling Green, B. Cornwell was in the hospital. I went to Sear, and on the way back, I stopped at a place on an exit on the road. I won't say where, and I thought, I'll just go to McDonald's, get a quick bite of lunch. And so I got in line, and I got up there and ordered, and I ended up being in that line for something like 45 minutes or an hour before I got my food. And I'm thinking, what is going on? Why is this like? And I'm getting angrier and angrier and angrier. And I'm thinking, I'm just going to pull out of this line. I'll go on down to Wendy's or whatever, something next door or something like that. I'm not going to put up with this and everything. I finally got up to the window, and the guy told me what the bill was. And as I'm handing him my money, he says, sir, we want to apologize for the long wait today. He said, it turned out that just as I pulled up and gave my order, their computer system went down. completely. And they were having to do it all on a register, which I'm sure was about to kill some of them. But at any rate, they were doing it all by hand on a register. A calculator. Who would have a register nowadays, right? Calculator. And they were doing that. Well, my anger was growing and growing and growing. I wanted to get up there and say, do you all not know what you're doing in here? Do you need some more training? That's what I wanted to say. And I don't mind telling you, it took all of my energy to hold back and not pull out of line. And when I got up there, he said, we're very sorry. We apologize. I wanted to say, well, you could comp me my meal, but he didn't do that. And but I kept quiet about it. When I pulled away, I had a much better feeling about myself and about the people there, because we did not get into an argument. I did not chew anybody out. I didn't, you know. And I for a long time after I left there, I thought to myself, Gary, you may not have liked it, but it helped you. And it did. It helped me. Okay, Dennis, I didn't mean to.
First of all, you're not going to line up in the local newspaper because Danny White has passed those remembrance her as being the gospel columnist.
Oh, uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
All this other stuff can be covered under that one or two words are sober-minded. It describes everything that you are being.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the idea of clear thinking, calm thinking, and a reasoned and patient response to life, period. Am I the only one that gets aggravated with things? Is there anyone in here that you get aggravated at things?
Road rage, if not.
What?
Road rage.
Yeah.
It's never entered my mind.
Yeah.
I find that I get less aggravated if I always assume good intent.
Yeah.
And I don't get frustrated on the road like I used to, because I always think that person could be saving my life. Getting in an accident or something.
Uh-huh.
But I find that if I always assume good intent, I get a lot less aggravated
about it. Yeah.
And I give myself a pep talk before I walk
out.
I have.
All right. Well, one of the things is, and when we meet individuals, we may meet that individual for only one time in all of life. What do we want to leave with them? And we want to leave a good impression. It doesn't mean that we cannot object to things. It does not mean that we cannot somehow or another, this young man at that restaurant, drive-through, very first thing out of his mouth, we're sorry for the delay. We know that you've been waiting. I'm sorry about this. Our computer system went down, and he gave the time reference, and I thought about it, and it was the time that I pulled up. And it all just went down.
We are too dependent upon mechanical planes. One year ago, when I was in Hawaii, we went to a fast food, and their computer went down, and the young lady had to count change back in hand. She couldn't do it.
Yeah.
We're just
so
dependent on mechanical
things. Well, we are, and listen, life itself can be aggravating. Gary?
I'll go back to what Jesus said. Let your light so shine that men may see your good works. Be what? Glorify God. So if he doesn't glorify God, and I'm the fourth person in the hospital, but if he doesn't glorify God, just don't say it. Don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
So you did exactly the right thing, even though it took that patience, which is Paul's virtue.
Mm-hmm. And Paul... And Paul even said, be angry and sin not. And so anger is going to be something that arises in us, but let us be careful how we handle that. And one who's in a leadership position, such as an elder, that's something that with handling things from day to day and so forth as that, that it may become very difficult. And so in that position, you've got to be able we've got to be able to control ourselves, period. It doesn't matter what it is. If you're going through a drive-through, if you're standing at a counter, if you're waiting on somebody to come by and wait on you or something like that, there are just times that you have to have a release, but you need to be careful about that release. And when it comes to one who is an elder in the church, the same thing applies. The elder sets an example. When out at Teen Week, and they still do this, but we used to at Teen Week, I don't remember who started it, it may have been going on. I went out there first with Gerald Baker. But Gerald Baker had a thing that at the end of Teen Week, there was best teen male and best teen female. And by the time I came along, the basic idea was this boy or this young girl represents what we want Teen Week to be. And if I were to go to a congregation and talk about Bible camp, what we are and what we're trying to do, that I could take this young man or this young woman with me and say, this is an example of what we have at Teen Week, all right? And you want it to be good, all right? Every member of the church, when we go out into the world, we're setting an example, we're doing something before others that lets them know how we are. That's something that we have to, but when it comes to an elder, oh, this man's the leader of the congregation there? Yes. Yes, he's a leader. Well, I mean, I saw him the other day do this, or I heard him say this, or whatever, and everything. And then people begin to judge the entire congregation by the elder. And you say, well, that's not right. I know that. I understand that. You go to the grocery store, and here's the produce section. If you don't appreciate the produce section, you need to talk to Peter and Laura Tickner. They went to Walmart in Benton when they first got here and bought fruit. And she said, oh my, I've never seen such fruit in all this fruit and everything. And she was going on. And I said, you thought that was good? And she said, yeah. I said, well, the Walmart up in Paducah out there by the mall has a larger section. But Mike, they loved Walmart's food and fruit section there. And boy, I mean, and when so we went over to the house to see them, and on the table there was everything you could think of. Bananas, strawberries, I think there were some blueberries or something like that. I don't remember. It was just, I guess, whatever Walmart had in stock that day. And they thought that was just tremendous, you know, to have all of that. And that to them said something very positive about Walmart. They were very impressed by that. When we go out, we need to remember people judge us by what they see. Now, if you're looking at this produce, and what if here you are in the banana section and all of the bananas are rotten? You're not, you know. And then what if all the bananas are good except for this one bunch? Well, there are people in the world, and let's admit it, you may not be one of them, but let's admit it. I went over there to get bananas, and they had this rotten banana. I said, I wouldn't eat any of the others because of that one rotten banana there. We do that. There are people that do that. Sometimes we do it ourselves. But we don't want an elder in the church. So I hope Bill and Jackie, sorry about that, talking about you. I'm not talking about you two. These are good men. I've never seen them do anything. I want you to know that. But you want an elder to be an example of what you have at the church. Now, not only an example, but this is a leader. How's he going to lead me? I never will forget when Kevin first started running cross country, his coach was Trent Lovett. And Trent didn't just tell the boys, okay, I want you to do this and I want you to do that and everything. John, Trent got out there and ran with them. Jason ran cross country. You know what I'm talking about. He got out there and ran with them. Now, if I had to do that, I'd die on the first day. But he would get out there and he would run that course with them. And they would be doing different things and he would urge them on. Coach Carrick does the same thing today. He's a runner. I don't know how many of you know Chuck Gullo, but boy, he had a positive, and he, so let me tell you this, and I want you to think about this for just a moment. Chuck Gullo is in the Hall of Fame, Athletic Hall of Fame in the state of New York, High School Athletic Hall of Fame. He's in a Hall of Fame in college sports, and don't ask me which one, but he's in the Hall of Fame in the state of Kentucky, primarily in Kentucky for the coaching that he did in New York and everything for the running. But he would run with his runners. And he didn't tell them, now I'm in the Hall of Fame, so you do like I do, and you'll get there also. He just said, if you want to win, you've got to train, and he would run with them. So you want the elder to be somebody who can lead and who demonstrates the qualities that we're looking at here and who, for I don't know exactly how to put it, but basically is an example of what the entire congregation is like. Okay. So that's the idea behind all this. And incidentally, not greedy of filthy lucre. Lucre is not a name of a little boy. Some people have thought, not greedy of money. Not covetous. Not greedy of getting more and more and more and things like this. And remember that there is a provision later for those who lead that if they are devoting their time to the church so much that they may be losing an income otherwise, that the church can pay them, can reimburse them, remunerate them, or whatever. All right, so an elder should not be one who is doing this so that he can get paid to do it, but even in life generally, he is not to, because this would be an indication of covetousness. And then he says, patient. Well, no, okay, let me skip that one, go to the one that says not covetous. That is one who is not always wanting more and more and never satisfied. And then one who is patient, who is able to wait things out. The word patience oftentimes involves the idea of endurance. Endurance in the midst of something that would stir things up and cause a problem. He is enduring, whatever it is. James said, you've heard of the patience of Job. It would be better to render that the endurance of Job. Because if you look back, there's a few times when Job is saying to God, why did you do this to me? And things, and he's questioning, I want you to answer. I'm demanding that you come down here and answer me. You know, it's better the idea of endurance through whatever difficulties, whatever things are going on, life and society and things like this, to endure. And this is sort of the idea. And endurance involves patience. So one who's an elder in the church must be patient. He must be one who is self-controlled. He must be one who can endure and go through all of the trials and the difficulties and things like that. That's what he has in mind there. And then, and I think I've already discussed the brawler, one that ruleth well his own house. We've talked about this very briefly. The idea is that he is managing and taking care of his home. He's being responsible as a husband, as a father, whoever is in his home. And he, one of the things I've been so impressed with as Peter and Claire were with is that both of their children are very courteous. And I listened to the way they spoke to their parents and the way their parents spoke to them. And you could see a mutual love and respect for each person in the family and the position that they had. You could see that. All right. Sort of the same idea here. One that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity while his children are at home and he has authority. They recognize that authority. They submit to their father's authority and so forth. And then, if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Let me mention very quickly, because I've already talked about it, but that phrase, take care of, is a phrase that in Greek is found only three times in the Greek New Testament. This is one of those times. The other two are in the parable of the Good Samaritan. And it's a Greek word, epimeleomai, take care of. What did the Good Samaritan do? If an elder wants to know what this means, just go to the Good Samaritan. What did he do? He sees this man. He stops and he took care of him, dressed his wounds and took care of him. Then he takes him to the inn and he tells the man there at the inn, take care of him and I will pay you. Here's money to do that. And when I come back, I'll check with you to see if you have, if you're out any money and everything. Take care of. All right, if you were to take that parable and look, you see, number one, alertness. You also see compassion. And incidentally, the Samaritan is taking care of a man that Jesus, in all likelihood, is Jewish. Not a Samaritan, one who is Jewish. One who did not love him or like him or want to be around him, but he stopped and took care of him. There is alertness to the need. There is compassion. And there is, I'm going to call it hands-on responsibility. He doesn't just get the man to say, here, I'm going to take you to the local inn. He dresses the man's wounds. He helps him. He takes care of him. Brings him to this certain level here so that he can be transported somewhere where he can get better care, more complete and thorough care and all. So that's the idea. Then notice verse 6, not a novice. And basically that simply means not a new Christian, not one who is just recently. It's someone who has been converted. And they have. I held a meeting over in eastern Kentucky one time. I don't think I had ever been that far east in Kentucky without being on an interstate. There was no interstate. But I held a gospel meeting, and the preacher said, well, we're going to go down, and we're going to meet with this family down here in another town. And brethren, I still don't know where I was. My mother's ancestors came through there, and I'm glad they found their way because I didn't. If it hadn't been for this preacher, I'd have never known. But he was telling me about an individual that was baptized. There was a congregation that there was only one man in the congregation. The rest were women. And so this man had taught somebody, another man, and baptized him. And so he baptized the man for the remission of sins. He came up out of the water and he said, now, I appoint you and me as elders in this congregation. And probably not a wise choice. Probably not a wise choice. He needs to be someone who is experienced, who has some knowledge, some wisdom, some understanding. And these things don't happen to me. How long does it take? Well, I don't know. But I do know that Paul went into Ephesus and there was no congregation there. And 3 years later, there was not only a congregation, there were elders. So, in the period of 3 years, what did Paul do? My guess, I could not prove it from Scripture, but my guess is that Paul did a lot of preaching and teaching. He even says in Acts chapter 20 that we taught publicly and house to house. It would not surprise me in the least if Paul had a training session where he took the men and talked to them about these things. I don't know what he did, but I know that within 3 years, they had elders. Some years ago, I was talking to a preacher. I won't say where he was. He's retired now, but he was in an area. The congregation he served in had 4, 5, 6 elders. Strong congregation. They were doing some good work and things. And I said, well, there's a fellow I know that's preaching in your same area. And I mentioned his name. He said, yeah, I know the man. And I thought, okay, the way he said that, there's something wrong here. And he said, that man is preaching for a congregation of 300. And I said, wow. I said, well, very well organized. And so he said, no. He said, they don't have any elders. And I said, congregation of 300, why don't they have elders? And he said, he says that there are no men qualified. So you've got to figure, okay, there's something wrong with the congregation or there's something wrong with the preacher. My guess is there was something wrong with the preacher. But be that as it may. So Anyway, next week, we'll get into that last phrase, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. That was a good one right there. We'll get into that. should have brought out. I forgot about that.
Good morning. Good morning. It's good to see everyone on this beautiful, bright, sunshiny Sunday morning. Glad everybody's able to make it out. And please be careful later this week. They are talking about some wintry mix. And be careful when you're out on the roads and things like that. We don't. Peter and Laura Tickner are still here. And I was hoping that she would get to see some snow, but because of the things coming, we're going to have to take them to the airport early tomorrow, take them to Nashville. They'll spend a night or two there before they catch their plane. But for them, snow is a wonderful, wonderful experience. They'd like to see all of it that they can. I told them we're not as much in love with that kind of thing as they are. But I guess if you don't ever see it in your life except in a picture, it's a real treat. But they were at a McDonald's here about 2 weeks ago when it snowed, and Laura got out in the parking lot, and she was just jumping and carrying on and screaming, and somebody came out there and asked what was wrong, and she said, nothing. This is the first time I've ever seen snow. They took a video of her in that. So we're very accustomed to it. It's not a, you know, but for them, it's a whole new experience. But anyway, they will be leaving tomorrow to go back to Australia. Their flight leaves out Wednesday. Please pray for them that they'll have a safe trip. The flight from Nashville to Dallas is not all that long, but from Dallas to Australia is 17 hours. 17 hours stuck in a plane, nonstop. So please keep them in your prayers. Of the sick that we have, Bob Mobley and Barbara are in Clarksville at a daughter's house, and Barbara is still taking dialysis at the hospital. Bob is recovering and taking home therapy. April Lovell, this is Vicki English's sister. She was diagnosed with cancer several years ago. They treated it, but it has come back. The prognosis is not good. Now, in that same connection, Johnny Westerfield, this is Bill's sister-in-law, they found that her cancer had returned things, and they just couldn't do anything. She passed away, and I do not have any funeral arrangements. I believe she lived in Owensboro, and so please keep them in your prayers.
In Louisville.
Also, Nate was telling me a moment ago, Jenny's grandmother, Ampira Long, is in the hospital. And she's in ICU, and we want to remember her in our prayers as well. It's good to see Gail Fuller here today. The doctor said she'd be feeling 100% better, and she just nearly ran down the aisle to get to her seat today. But she's doing better, and we're glad for that. I'm trying to remember very quickly. I'm doing this off the top of my head. Am I leaving someone out on the sick that ought to be mentioned? Yes, Kim, that was it. Nate told me a moment ago, Kim is at home, some sinus problems and things. Please keep her in your prayers. I know she would appreciate that. Notice in the bulletin, the elders in talking are wanting to start a program of helping people with projects around the house, things that need to be done. And if you will look at the announcement in the bulletin, it will give you the information. You can talk to the elders about that, but it would involve simply providing people who would come and help take care of whatever the job is. And so if you are in need of someone doing that kind of thing that you just cannot do yourself or something, please talk to the elders about that. And this will be a developing thing, and hoping that it will continue to grow. The widowhood ministry, again, is a relatively new ministry. A very good thing, and we want to encourage others to come. We will be hosting one night of the Summer Youth Series, July the 25th, And I have that in the bulletin. Please mark that on your calendar, and that night, be sure to be here and encourage others to be here. Brinesburg has one of the larger ones during the course of a year, and I do think that we can take a great deal of pride in that, but one of the things that I hear people say is we enjoy going to Brinesburg. Everything is so good, and the food. The preacher there is wonderful. We love him to death. A few of you picked up on that. But anyway, but please remember the Summer Youth Series. And there's two notes in there for the LLLs. One, thanking them this past Wednesday night, they prepared walking tacos for Peter and his family and all of us that came. Enjoyed that. But they will also meet Thursday, February the 2nd at 9 a.m. to deliver Bibles to a program called Moses' Basket in Benton. And if you will read the article on, or excuse me, the notice on that, it will tell you more about what that is. So thankful for everyone being here today. If you're a visitor, please stay after and give us the opportunity to meet you and to welcome you to the services and invite you to come back at every opportunity that you can. Let us take the time to make our hearts and minds right, to worship God in spirit and in truth. And when we leave today, let us go out of here to be a light for all of those who are around us.
Our first song this morning will be number 517, 517. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day, day I will never forget. After I wandered in darkness away, Jesus my Savior I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend, He met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling with joy I am telling, He made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down, and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine, justified fully through Calvary's love. Oh, what a standing is mine! And the transaction so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came, took the offer of grace He did proffer. He saved me, oh, praise His dear name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Now the hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I've a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believe. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from His precious hand I receive. Heaven came down and glory fill my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Number 875. If for the prize we have striven, after our labors are o'er, rest to our souls will be given on the eternal shore. Home of the soul, beautiful home, there we shall rest, never to roam, free from all care. Happy and bright, Jesus is there. He is the light off in the storm. Lonely are we, sighing for home, longing for thee. Beautiful home of the ransomed beside the crystal sea. Yes, a sweet rest is remaining for the true children of God, where there will be no complaining, never a chastening rod. Home of the soul, beautiful home, there we shall rest, never to roam. Free from all care, happy and bright, Jesus is there. He is the light off in the storm. Lonely are we, sighing for home, longing for thee. Beautiful home of the ransomed beside the crystal sea. Soon the bright homeland adorning, we shall behold the glad dawn. Lean on the Lord till the morning, trust till the night is gone. Home of the soul, beautiful home, there we shall rest, never to roam. Free from all care, happy and bright, Jesus is there. He is the light off in the storm. Lonely are we, sighing for home, longing for thee. Beautiful home of the ransomed beside the crystal sea. Number 390. After we sing this song, Brother Bill Westerfield will lead us in our opening prayer. Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, feed me till more. Bread of heaven, feed me. fountain whence the healing waters flow. Let the fiery cloudy pillar lead me on my journey through. Strong deliverer, be thou still my strength and shield. Strong deliverer, be thou still my strength and shield. When I tread the verge of Jordan, mid my anxious fears subside, bear me through the swelling current, land me safe on Canaan's side. Songs of praises I will ever give to thee. Songs of praises I will ever give to thee.
Pray with me. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you this first day of the week, where you have commanded us together as Christians, Father, to worship you. Father, there are times when we do not feel that the adjectives, the great, wonderful adjectives that we have for you, Father, are enough. They just don't seem to justify you. But yet, Father, we know how great thou art, that you are in control of all things. You're the creator of all things. Father, we just thank you so much that we're Christians, that we believe in you. And Father, we pray that people everywhere will stop and think about their lives. Think about the reason they are here. What purpose do I have? Where am I going? What is the direction in my life? We pray, Father, that they'll seek out your word and find the answers to those questions. Help us, Father, to be examples of Christian living so that they'll come to us and ask us why we live the way we do, why we believe what we do, so that they might become Christians themselves. We might be able to help them in every way that we can. Father, we just thank you for all the blessings you give us. We thank you for this opportunity to be here today. And we pray, Father, we'll worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, we are mindful of all those that need our prayers. We have many that are sick. We have many that are grieving over loved ones that have passed away. And Father, we have many that we need to pray for that have that dreaded disease of cancer. And we just pray for all of them, Father. Help us to think of them each and every day. Father, we just are so thankful for our Lord and our Savior, who was willing to come to this earth to die for us. We're thankful for his life. We know, Father, that he is the cornerstone of the church. And all the foundation of the church is laid from his teachings. We're so thankful, Father, that he was willing to come and make the great sacrifice that he did on the cross for us, the shedding of his blood for us. We pray, Father, we'll remember that each and every day of our lives. We know that it is only through him that we can have salvation, Father. Thank you, Father, for this congregation. We pray that you'll be with us. Help us to be a shining light in this community. Help us to continue to uphold your word and never compromise it in any way. And people will know they can come here and be taught the Bible and what God, what you want us to believe, Father, how you want us to live. Thank you, Father, for all the blessings of this life. We pray that you will continue with us. Shine that light upon our pathway, Father, and help us to know where, how to walk. And we pray, Father, that we'll stay on that straight and narrow pathway. And someday, Father, we will enter into that gate that takes us to heaven. Continue to bless us. Forgive us of our sins. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
To prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper this morning, we'll be singing number 315, 315. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and pour contempt on all my pride. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow me. Such love and sorrow meet, O thorns composed so rich a
God in his word told us on each first day of the week to partake of the Lord's Supper in remembrance of the Lord and Savior who died on that cruel cross. And we do so every first day of the week here at Brightsburg. Would you bow? Almighty God, we want to thank you for the opportunity to gather around thy table this morning, Lord, to take of this bread, which to the Christian represents the body of our Lord and Savior who died on that cruel cross. We pray that we'll examine ourselves, Lord, and take in a worthy manner. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're also told to take of the fruit of the vine. And if you would, at this time, we'll pray for the fruit of the vine. Lord, again, we want to thank you for this day and our many blessings. And Lord, an opportunity to gather around thy table. Lord, we thank you for the fruit of the vine, which represents the blood our Savior spilled on that cruel cross for us. We pray that we'll examine ourselves, Lord, and take in a worthy manner. In Jesus' name, amen. That concludes the Lord's Supper. We're also commanded to give. And there's a box out there in the foyer if anyone would like to donate to the contributions of the work of the church here at Brightsburg, do so. At this time, we'll pray for the offering. Almighty God, we want to thank you again for this Lord's Day and the opportunity to gather around thy table, Lord. We thank you for many blessings, our material blessings, Lord, and the opportunity to work and make a living for our families and work support the work of the church, Father. We pray we also will do all these things in your name. In Jesus. Amen.
If you're using your books today and want to mark our song of encouragement, number 947. 947. And if you'd like to stand, we'll be singing number 898. 898. As I travel through life with its trouble and strife, of a glorious hope to give cheer on the way, soon my toil will be o'er and a rest on that shore, where the night has been turned into day. Up in the beautiful Paradise Valley, by the side of the River of Life. Up in the valley, the wonderful valley, will be free from all pain and all strife. There we shall live in the roasted garden underneath the shade of the evergreen tree. How I long for the Paradise Valley, where the beauty of heaven I'll see. As I roam the hillside or list to the tide, as I pluck the sweet flowers that grow in the dale, a faint picture is there of a land bright and fair, where perennial flowers ne'er fail. Up in the beautiful Paradise Valley, by the side of the River of Life. Up in the valley, the wonderful valley, will be free from all pain and all strife. There we shall live in the rose-tinted garden, neath the shade of the evergreen tree. How I long for the Paradise Valley, where the beauty of heaven I'll see. Though your garden is rare, it is not to compare with the flowers that bloom in the garden above. In the midst of it growth, Sharon's perfect sweet rose, 'tis the wonderful flower we love. Up in the beautiful Paradise Valley, by the side of the River of Life. Up in the valley, the wonderful valley, will be free from all pain and all strife. There we shall live in the rose-tinted garden, neath the shade of the evergreen tree. How I long for the Paradise Valley, where the beauty of heaven I'll see.
It's truly wonderful to see everyone today. So grateful for everyone's ability to be out and the opportunity that we have to come here and to study and worship God in spirit and in truth. And we encourage you to take your Bibles, turn to Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2. And let me, while you're turning to that, let me remind you that Peter and Laura Tickner will be going home tomorrow. Well, going to Nashville tomorrow, flying out on Wednesday. Please remember them in your prayers for a safe trip. Millie and I have been able to spend quite a bit of time with them, and I was telling Alice and Beverly a moment ago about an incident. They were at the house the other night, and I was talking to Jaron. We got talking about movies and what our favorite movies were, and I mentioned that my favorite movie is McClintock. And Alice knows exactly what I'm talking about. She's probably seen it, well, not as many times as me, but it a lot. And I said, I like a good Western and John Wayne. And he said, what's a Western and who is John Wayne? Said, we're going to send social services after Peter and Claire for not raising their children in the right way. So I said, come in here just a moment. So we went back to the apartment. I turned on television to Grit. And I said, this is a Western. And he thoroughly enjoyed that. But at any rate, as much as things are the same, there's a lot of differences also. But we have thoroughly enjoyed having them with us. And they are giving reports. Peter's giving a report over at Eagle Way in Hopkinsville right now. And then later this evening, he'll be at Northside in Mayfield. But we've enjoyed having them with us, and there's been a lot of new experiences for them, and they've told us things about Australia and things like that. It's been very, very good for us. I think we've learned a lot and enjoyed their friendship and the opportunity to be here. Turn your Bibles, as I said, to Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2. And as we'll talk about this passage in just a moment, I will read that as the text. And then as I read it for the text, realize that a little bit later the text will not be discussed at the first as much as it will be toward the end, trying to make the point that I want to talk about here. You see that I've entitled the lesson Straddling the Fence, and that's something that all of us are familiar with. All of us are familiar with the idea that there are decisions that we have to make in life, and those decisions are not always easy. And so we talk about straddling the fence. That, in other words, well, I may need to do this, but there's this to think about, and so forth. And so we talk about that. And part of the problem that comes in, sometimes it's very serious questions about what we're going to do with our lives. There are young people who go away to college that they're not fully sure what they're going to do for a vocation, and so they're straddling the fence. Well, I'd like to do this, but I want to do this, and so forth, and they're trying to figure, what do I need to do for the rest of my life? This is a very important decision when it comes down to marriage. Do I want to marry this individual? I see this individual as someone that I love very much, that I want to spend my life with, but at the same time, I wonder about this, and so we're straddling the fence on that. And there are many other questions that come to our mind. We also have even developed another phrase, and that is that the grass is always greener on the other side of the fence. It doesn't matter where you are, you look over, it's always easy to see something that other people have that we don't have and think that they have, that they've really got it. And we become disappointed, we become disillusioned in our own lives because we don't have these things, and maybe we don't realize fully what we do have. Some years ago, I went to Murray State University. They had a night where they had William F. Buckley Jr. lecturing. And I had been an admirer of his, and I wanted to go hear him. And he got to talking about what we have in America. One of the things he pointed out, he said, well, Russia had, the wall had come down, and there had been a change in leadership and so forth. And he said, today in Russia, people talk about this being good and this being good and this being good. And he said, but what you don't understand is that with all of those things that look good, there's a lot of complications also. And he said, Japan is doing this, China's doing this, and all of these different countries around the world. And he said, somebody's doing this better than... And he said, the thing is that, yes, you can look around the world, you will find people who are doing some things better than we are, but you will never find a nation doing all of these things as well as we are. And he said, living in America today is a tremendous privilege. And I even bought a book later on that was based on that lecture that he gave. And in it, he talks about, the title of the book has to do with the sense of gratitude, being thankful and happy with what we have and realizing that things are good. But back to the idea of straddling the fence, that there are times that we straddle that fence thinking, well, I want to do this and I'd like to do this also. I'd like to live maybe in the Caribbean. I go down there, do mission work. I've learned my way around. I like the food in the Caribbean. I like the people and things like this. I like that. But at the same time, we have advantages and blessings here that I would rather have here. So you say, well, you're sort of straddling the fence. Yes, in one way, no, in another way. But that idea of straddling the fence comes in when we begin to talk about, well, where am I going in life? You know, what am I going to do with my life? What is my life like right now? What is it that God wants me to do? And here's God's way, here's my way, and I'm doing this, but I'm not so sure that I need to be doing this. And we begin to question these things in our mind. And I think sometimes we make a decision that is not always the best decision. It's not the best informed decision. It's not a decision that is made out of wisdom and understanding. And we think, well, this is the way that's going to make me happiest. But what we really need to understand is that we have to make a decision about what we're going to do, and we have to follow that decision and do, according to what God says, the very best of our ability, what is the right thing to do. In Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, this passage will become more important as we go along through the lesson. But Paul says, "If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on the things of the earth." Last week, I was talking about the book of Ecclesiastes and Solomon's struggle with life. And we pointed out from there that in chapter 1, verses 1 through 11, Solomon says, well, I've discovered that that life is vanity. Everything is vanity in life. I understand also that everything passes away very quickly. I understand also that there's no happiness in some of the things that we see under the sun, as he used that phrase there. That idea of under the sun, that is where we live today on this earth. And Solomon said, I tried all kinds of things in life, and I found out that I wasn't really happy. None of these things made me happy. I thought that there would be happiness in laughter, mirth, you know, and things. It wasn't that. He said, I tried to find happiness in wine, and he said, well, that didn't work out. I tried to find happiness in knowing more, being well-educated, learning all that I could, gathering information from all over the world as we know it, and he said, that didn't make me happy. And he went on to say, well, I thought maybe riches or building great buildings and things like this. And Solomon said, I didn't find happiness in all of this. And then beginning there right after that and going into chapter 2 and on after that, for about 6 or 7 chapters, Solomon basically talks about all of the things in life. Well, a man works very hard. He saves up all of this money. Next thing you know, he dies and he leaves it to someone else. Or I've seen this happen. A man will do this and he'll be a man of integrity. He'll be honest, and yet somebody will come along and by something that they say or do will destroy his reputation or whatever it may be. And he goes through these things, but then he finally comes to a point where in the discussion there in Ecclesiastes, he begins to change, and you see this change taking place where the attention is drawn away from this world and happiness here to finding happiness with God. Solomon teaches us that man is empty without God. Now, one of the things that I want you to notice, and you have to go back to the very beginning of time, is that man sustains a relationship with God. The Bible tells us in Genesis 2 and verse 7 that God formed man out of the dust, from the dust of the ground. He breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. I want you to notice these three things there. Number one, God formed us out of the dust of the ground. He did not make us into an amoeba that developed over a long period of time. Evolution, as much as people want to believe in that and all, is not a true thing. It is not really scientific, though a lot of people think that it is. But evolution really does not answer our deepest, well, where did I come from? Well, you come from a monkey. Well, there's been a few times I've been told worse than that. But I suppose if I had to settle for one or the other, I'd settle for that over some of the other things I've been told. But the fact of the matter is, God created man, the Bible says so. And he breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life. So the breath that we have in us is divine to begin with, and man was made a living soul. In other words, there is an eternal aspect about man. That's who we are. So if you want to know then, well, what about my life with or without God? The first thing you have to remember is that our very existence depends on God creating us, and our eternal hope is based on the fact that we are an eternal being, our soul is, and that someday we're going to live on into eternity. But we're also told that man is sustained by God. Hey, you say, well, wait a minute, I've got a job, I'm making good money, I'm taking care of things, my wife and I, and all, we're working very hard and things like this. We're taking good care of ourselves. I don't care how much good you do, you cannot do that without God. It is God who sustains us. Acts chapter 17 and verse 28, Paul is speaking there at Mars Hill, and he talks about God and he says, "For in him we live and move and have our being." I need God. The only way that I make it through every day is the fact that God is with me, somehow sustaining this universe and things and the world in which I live. But then there's another thing about God, and I think that this is vitally important, and that is God says in Ezekiel chapter 18 and verse 4, every soul is mine. You want to know what belongs to God? We could go through the Bible, and there's a lot of things God says, that's mine, that's mine, that's mine, and on like this. Well, God possesses you, or that you belong to him. And he said, every soul is mine. Now, in other places, God says, well, every beast of the field is mine. And you could go on and talk about other things here that God says. But one of the things you need to remember is that with or without God, whatever your belief is, the very fact of the matter is, God says your soul belongs to him. And I think that that's important to remember. Now, the reason all of this is important is that when we choose life without God, we are choosing to be empty inside. You understand what I'm saying there? We are choosing to be empty. Life is not going to be good. When God is absent from your life, the very essence of your being is empty, and life is going to fail you. And we may try to fill the void with all kinds of things that end up being nothing. It could be our job. Maybe we just take a great deal of pleasure in that. Could be a hobby of some sort. Could be our family, whatever it is. And our families are good, and I don't want anyone to think that they're not good. But the fact of the matter is that life will fail us. And the book of Ecclesiastes reminds us that we need God. Life will fail you, but he tells us God will not fail you. He goes on to say that life can be frustrating, but God makes everything work together for good. Life can be disappointing, but God brings joy, and life ultimately ends in death, but God takes death and makes life. We need to remember that when it comes to God and man, it's not about me. It's not all about me. I don't know. Every time I think about the book of Ecclesiastes, I think about, I don't know if any of you remember that country music song several years ago. This guy's dating this woman, and he says, it's not all about you. I want some things too. And he talks about, I want this, I want this, I want this. And he said, it's not about you alone. You're not the only one here. I want some things myself, you see. God is saying, look, I gave you a good world to live in. And if you stop and think, it's a beautiful world that we live in. I'm not saying everything is perfect, but God is saying life is good. He is giving you that opportunity, but that life is good only because we have God. And this is the thing that we need to remember, that life without God is empty. And Solomon's advice to us is later on in Ecclesiastes 12 and verse 1, is to seek God in the period of time when we are young and let him be our help and our guide throughout life. Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth. While the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. He says, learn to all you can about God. Draw close to God in youth and let those principles guide you and lead you, and this will be the happiest life. And even when life gets bad later on, and he's talking there about old age and so forth, and he says even in older age, when you come down later, even when things are not going well, he says nonetheless, God will be with you. Solomon is telling us very simply that man is empty without God. But I want you to notice, Paul says something of the same thing. We're going to see some parallels here in just a moment. But Paul says, look, the world offers you nothing. I want you to notice the use of the word vanity, both in Solomon and in Paul. In Ecclesiastes, Solomon uses the word vanity to stand for that which is empty. and cannot give us any happiness whatsoever. In Ephesians, it stands for that which is empty and unproductive. The ideas are very similar, aren't they? A little bit different approach, but they're very similar here. But the total idea is that both Ecclesiastes and Ephesians present the idea that the world is full of empty thinking, empty promises, and empty results. In other words, you put your trust in the world, you're going to come out very disappointed with things. It's going to happen right now, or it will happen at the end of life. Now, I don't know how many people through my years of being a minister that I've talked to who have told me, Brother Knuckles, you know, there have been some things. I want to tell you something. I didn't do what I should have done, or I could have done better, or I regret this. And many of us oftentimes look back on our lives, and we have a lot of regrets over decisions that we've made or things that we've done, whatever it may be. We may have some regrets. And in the Bible, he acknowledges both in the Old and New Testament, God is telling us, yes, I know you're going to have some regrets, but the happiest life can be lived by minimizing those, and the way you do that is following God. And this is exactly what Paul tries to do. Paul says to us, the world offers nothing, and he urges us to turn to God. Here in Ephesians 4, verses 22 through 24, Paul is saying that you put off concerning the former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that you put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Put off the old man, put on the new man that is created by God. That old man, the young people used to sing a song out at Bible camp about the old man and the new man. I remember Kevin coming home from Bible camp singing that song. The old man was tattered and torn, you see. But the new man, well, he's a man who has been reborn. And so the old man has all of this going on in his life that's junk. All right? There, I said it. The old man has all of this going on in his life that is junk. But over here is God saying, get rid of that junk and I'll make you something else. I'm going to make you a new man. And I'm going to give you the things that you need. This is what we're looking for. And Paul says, put off that old man. Put on the new man that's created by God. And he talks about this old man, whereas the old man is fashioned after world and is marked by ignorance and hatred and dishonesty and uncontrolled desires. Get rid of that man and put on this new man that is created in righteousness and true holiness. And so in Ephesians, Paul is identifying the new man that is marked by so close of a relationship to God, so close that we take on a new identity and we have a relationship with others that is marked by love and kindness. This is what Paul is trying to get across. Both Solomon and Paul are telling you that old life is vain. That life as far as pertains to earth, that's not going to work. You need this other thing here. You know, I've said before, I've been a fan of the Andy Griffith Show, and many of you are. Do any of you remember the episode where the freezer breaks down? And Andy wants to buy a new freezer, and Aunt B says, no, we can get somebody to repair it. And the last person on earth you want fooling with that, it comes over and it's Gomer. And Gomer is there to fix that freezer, and he does something, and all the gas escapes and so forth like this. And Andy finally just goes out and buys a brand new freezer. God is saying, you can't take that old anymore. That old is worn out. It's gone. It's not going to carry the day. It's just not going to work. That is gone. You've got to have this new, and that's what he's pointing us to do. And so this is where we come to the text in Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. Solomon and Paul both are saying you have to make a choice. You can't straddle the fence any longer. He says the world offers us nothing, but it takes away everything. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. Jesus says, lay not up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Don't lay up your treasures here on earth. Those treasures, they're going to be left to someone else. They're going to rust. They're going, whatever it is, everything, they're not worth it. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves neither break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. He is telling us the treasures of earth do not last. The treasures of earth do not last. They're going to fade away, so don't do that. But then notice what else, James chapter 5, verse 3. All of the things that we have here and that we love, he says that your gold and silver is cankered, and the rust of your earthly treasures will be a witness against you. The rust of these things. You may have all these things. You may pile up a massive amount of wealth, material things, whatever it may be, trophies in your house from good things that you have done, medals and things like this. But he said all of these things are nothing. They will stand against you. And then Peter says in 2 Peter 3 and verse 10, everything pertaining to earth will someday be destroyed. Everything that you see here on earth, it doesn't matter what it is that we do, it doesn't matter what we build or anything, this world is going to be destroyed. Go through 2 Peter 3 and verse 10 sometime and look at that. And he talks about that the earth is going to be burned up, that it's going to melt, that the elements will be dissolved, everything will be gone. This world is not permanent. This world is going to be destroyed. And everything that we put here in this world is going to be destroyed with it. It's not going to last, but there's still going to be eternity. And so Paul says, seek the things which are above, Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2. Notice that he says, set your affections on things above. Have your heart, your whole heart, focused on the spiritual and eternal things. And he says, to that degree then, he says, approve the things that are excellent. And in Paul's mind, the excellent things are not just things that are good here on earth. There's a lot of good things in God's creation. But what he's talking about here, he talks about such things as love and spiritual growth and all of these things develop. Approve the things that are excellent, he says. And then in Matthew 22 and verse 37, make God the priority of your life. Matthew 22 and verse 37, Jesus said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. Notice Jesus doesn't say just do this. He says the first commandment, the great commandment, the one thing in life that's more important than everything else is making God the priority of our lives. Sometimes we don't do that. It's very easy to get something else in place. It's very easy to put other things before God. It's very easy in our personal life, our spiritual life, whatever it is. It's very easy to forget who we are and what our number one priority should be. And then Paul says in Colossians 1, verses 9 through 14, grow in wisdom and spiritual understanding. I think it's interesting that not only did Paul identify this as essential, but Paul tells the Colossian brethren, he says, I cease not to pray for you that you will grow in wisdom and in spiritual understanding. And as he talks about that, he talks about the results of these things. And he goes on to say, basically, he says, grow in wisdom and spiritual understanding so that we can walk worthy of the Lord. It's not the world. It's not the earth. It's not the things of the people around us. That we can walk worthy of the Lord so that we can bring forth fruit, so that we can be strengthened with all power, so that we can endure with patience unto all joy. In other words, all of this is one thing that leads to another. And as these things are growing in our lives, we become closer to God. So do you get what Paul is saying there? Paul is saying, choose God who will give you all you need to overcome and ultimately lead you to victory. That's what Paul is saying to these brethren. I want you to grow. But to grow, you're going to have to make God the number one priority in your life. Number two, choose the things that are excellent. Don't straddle the fence here between, well, there's this and then there's this. This thing here I know is going to be a lot more fun, but this over here, I think this is what God is wanting from me and so forth. And maybe we go back and forth. Maybe we straddle that fence not knowing what to do. But Paul is saying here that in those times when we face those decisions, always go with God. I wanted to emphasize this. Last week I talked about Solomon's struggle with life and what he experienced. And finally he comes down to the end there in Ecclesiastes 12 and verse 13. And he says, hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. I wanted to talk about that, and I did last week. And this week I wanted to show you that it's not just simply Solomon out of the Old Testament that's saying it, but here's the Apostle Paul saying the same thing in the New Testament, in the book of Ephesians, and telling us that the greater and the best and happiest life, the most fulfilling life, and incidentally, let me say this, happiness cannot always be equated with fulfillment. Happiness cannot always be equated with meaning, because people will find things that make them happy, you see. People will find things that make them feel good and all like that, but they may still walk away with this emptiness. There's something lacking. They may find temporary or worldly happiness, but the Bible is saying there's something more than that. They're saying instead of looking for happiness, look for fulfillment and meaning. When you find that fulfillment, when you find that meaning, you will find the happiness, as Paul would state it later on in Philippians, the peace that passes all understanding. This is what God wants for us today. So what is happening in your life right now? You know, Proverbs 14, verse 12, there's a way that seemeth right to a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. We may be straddling the fence. Maybe we're trying to figure out what's going on. Maybe we're going the wrong way or looking for the thing that Solomon couldn't find, and it's eluding you just like it did him. He found out that everything he said ended in death, and that's where we're headed if we're not looking to God. We need to turn our lives around. We need to do the best that we can to quit straddling that fence. Make a definite decision. Get across that fence. Make the decision, I'm going to follow Jesus Christ. And as the old song used to say, where he leads me, I will follow. Where he leads me, that's what I'm going to do. That's where I'm going. There is the ultimate way to happiness. I can remember being a boy and going to school, and I would tell Dad, I'd say, I don't know why I have to learn some of these things today. I don't know why the teachers, I don't know what good that's going to do for me. I'm not going to do that, whatever it is and everything. And Dad will say, you don't understand now, but you will understand later. And you know, I found out he was right. A lot of the things I didn't understand then, I understand now. And even though I didn't understand what use they would be for me then, I do see the use now. And I can honestly say that my life is better, I think. And I think I'm happier for those things. And it is the same way with God. There are some disappointments in life, but God takes care of us. Today, if you are one who is an erring Christian, maybe the world has consumed you and you're ready to come back, here's the time and opportunity for that. It's a wonderful time because you're among friends. It's a great time because we're here in the presence of the Lord during worship. It's a wonderful time because everything is situated such that we can take care of you. And so today, if you need to be restored to the fellowship of the saints, to God, and renew that direction in your life, what you're trying to do, this is the best place and time to do it. It may be that you're not a Christian. And this, again, is the best time and it's the best place because we have the baptistry ready. Everything is ready. And all of us would rather watch as you put on Jesus Christ than to do anything else right now. Our priority, our desire, our happiness can be fulfilled in you by making that decision to be baptized, to have your sins washed away, and to be added to the church, and to enjoy the promises that God has for you. Today, if you're subject to the invitation, won't you come while we stand and sing?
Jesus is tenderly calling thee home, calling today, calling today. Why from the sunshine of love wilt thou roam? Farther and farther away, calling today, calling today. Jesus is calling, is tenderly calling today. Jesus is calling the weary to rest. Calling today, bring him thy burdens and thou shalt be blessed. He will not turn thee away. Calling. calling today, calling today. Jesus is calling, is tenderly calling today. Jesus is pleading, oh, list to his voice. Hear him today, hear him today. They who believe on his name shall rejoice. Quickly arise and away. Calling today, calling today. Jesus is calling, tenderly calling today.
Thank you, everybody, for being here today, and look forward to seeing you again this afternoon. At this time, Brother John Ward will lead us in our closing prayer.
Problems they have.